I've got a table full of bricks here. I'm looking for all these red star-shaped ones. No matter how hard I try, I can't seem to find them all. What I could do is go through and look at every single brick to see if it's what I'm looking for, but that's gonna take a while. It'd be much better if I had a list stating the color and shape of every single brick and its exact location on the table. With this, I can then look up where the red stars are and then easily find them all without having to look at every single other brick. A database index is the same idea. It stores the values from the indexed columns and pointers to where those rows are in the table. So with this, you can find a few rows quickly. So how do you create indexes and how do they make your SQL faster? Let's find out. To create an index, simply give it a name, state which table it's on, and list the columns you want to index. The index then stores the values in these columns, along with a pointer to the row which has this value. With the index in place, every time you insert, update, or delete a row, the database changes the corresponding index entries. So once it's in place, you can benefit from faster queries without any further action on your part. Note, Oracle Database only indexes rows where at least one column has a non-null value. If all the columns are null, then that row doesn't appear in the index. Okay, but how is using the index any more effective than reading the table itself? Well, for a start, the index is usually a smaller data structure than the table it's on. You're only storing values from the indexed columns and their row pointers, instead of every single column in the table. So it's just less work to read every entry in the index than it is to read every row in the table. But the real power of indexes is they enable you to find a few rows quickly. So how do they do this? We'll find out by looking at the most common index structure in relational databases, the Btree. As you can probably guess by the name, these store values in a tree structure. Each node in the tree is a database block. And like all trees, the index starts at its root. If you create an index on the brick's weight, the root splits these weights into ranges, along with a pointer to a child block for each range. Each of these children then further split the range into smaller subranges, and so on down the tree until you get to the leaves. These leaves store each non-null weight value and a pointer to the row with that value. If you want to use this index to find the value 2, you start at the root and see this value falls in the first range. So you go to the leftmost child. From here, again, you see that 2 falls in the first range and go to the leftmost child, where you can find a pointer to the row. So that's 3 IOs to read the index. It's also 3 IOs if you want to find the value 991. But this time you work along the right-hand edge of the index. In fact, it's 3 IOs to find any single index entry. This is because all the leaf blocks are at the same depth and the row pointers are only in the leaves. This is a key feature of Btrees. They are balanced. So it's the same amount of work to find any single entry, which in computer science terms is order log n. So even for a table storing millions of rows, you can find any one row in just a few IOs. This makes them incredibly efficient for single row lookups. But what if many rows have the value you're searching for? A Btree is an ordered data structure. It sorts all the leaf entries by the column values, then the row pointers. So consecutive values are next to each other, and the leaf blocks form a doubly linked list with pointers to the next and previous leaf block in the series. So if you want to find all the rows with weights between 90 and 110, the database starts by searching for the smallest value that's greater than or equal to 90. Once it's found this, it then walks along the leaves until it hits the upper limit. So again, this is nice and efficient. You just walk down the index once, then across however many leaves match your search. So you've created your nice shiny new index. How do you know if the database used it? Just look for the index name in the execution plan. There's an index on color, so this query can count all the red rows using an index range scan of that index. But we're only searching for one value, so why is it scanning a range? Remember, the index has an entry for every single non-null row. So to find all the red rows, the database must walk through, scan, all the red entries in the index. So it's working through a range of entries in the index. This is the most common form of index access. But there is a special case where the database is guaranteed to find at most one row, an index unique scan. This happens when you've got equality conditions on all the columns of a unique index. These guarantee that at most one row can have a given set of values for the index columns. This prevents duplicates and improves data quality. You create one by adding the unique keyword to your create index statement. You can also get one by defining a primary key or unique constraint. If there's not already an index on these columns, the database will create a unique one for you automatically. Finally, the database may read every entry in the index with an index full scan. Like a full table scan, this reads the whole index. The simplest case where this can happen is when your query only selects the columns in an index, without a where clause. Because the index is usually smaller than the table, it's quicker to read the index than the table. This highlights another benefit of indexes. They can make your SQL faster by avoiding the table altogether. Let's say I want to find my red bricks here. So I'll get my red bricks and get rid of all these other ones. Bit noisy. So we'll just get it. So we've got just the red bricks. And once I've done that, I want to group them by shape. So we'll get the cubes there, those cuboids there, and these other various shapes here. And then once I've done that, I want to count how many I've got of each shape. If the table only has an index on color, it can use this to get the red rows, but it has to go to the table to find all the shapes, which you can see by the table access by index row ID operation. If instead you create an index on color and shape, then once again, the database can read just the index, potentially saving itself a lot of work. So if you have a multi-column index, how does the database store and search these values? The index sorts the rows using the columns as they appear in the index, left to right. So an index on color, then shape, first splits the rows into color ranges, then subdivides these into shape ranges. So if I'm looking for red cuboids, we find the red entries, then search within these for the cuboids. We can also use this index when searching for all the red bricks. Just find the first red entry, ignore the shape, and return all the rows from this section of the index. So, you've created some indexes, looked at the execution plan, and found the database isn't using any of them. Why? Well, there are two fundamental reasons for this. Firstly, the database may be unable to use the index. Secondly, it may have decided it's just more work to use the index than read the table itself. We'll explore the second reason in the next episode. For now, we'll focus on what makes the database unable to use an index. In the previous example, we created an index on color and shape, which gave a nice performance boost for our query finding all the red bricks and grouping them by shape. But what if we want to find all the cubes of any color? This column is second in the index. So the index first sorts the rows by color, and the cubes are spread throughout the whole index, meaning we're no longer restricted to a small section of it and will have to read the whole thing. So the database is unlikely to use it.
To avoid this problem, ensure that the leftmost columns in the index all appear in your WHERE clause, ideally with equality conditions. But even when you do this, there can be another problem, applying functions to the columns in your index. For example, let's say customers have entered colors in all sorts of case. Some are lowercase, some are upper, and some are crazy mix of the two.
There's an index on color, so when searching for rows in a specific case, the database will use it. But what if you want to find all the red bricks, regardless of case? You could uppercase the color column and compare this to the text red in capitals, but do this and you'll find that the database no longer uses the color index.
So why is this and what can we do about it?
The values stored in the index are the regular column values. To ensure that we only find entries matching your search, you need to go through every single index entry and apply the function to it.
Which kind of defeats the point of having an index, right? Now, at this point you might say, isn't uppercasing the text lowercase red, the same as red in capitals, obvious? Well, perhaps to us humans, but computers are pretty dumb. The only way it knows this for sure is to run the function. Luckily, there is a way around this. You can store the result of the function in the index by creating a function-based index.
To do this, use the function in your create index statement, and the database stores its result in the index. To ensure the database uses this index, use the function in your WHERE clause in exactly the same way it appears in your index. Even small differences can stop the database using it.
But it's better if you can avoid applying a function to the column altogether. For example, instead of adding one to a column, subtract one from your search variable. So, to give the database the best chance of using your index, ensure that the leftmost columns of that index all appear in your WHERE clause, and that you apply no functions to the columns in the index. But even when you do this, the database may still decide not to use it at all. We'll explore further why this can happen in the next episode.
Thanks for watching. Have you got any more questions about how to create indexes or the index types available in Oracle Database? Let us know in the comments and subscribe for more SQL tips.